What's up guys, back again with another video. So I recently acquired a Commodore C16 computer, also known as the baby brother to the Commodore 64. And in this video, we're going to go ahead and give it the full restoration treatment and see how it turns out. I picked up this Commodore 16 computer back in April. I've always wanted a C16, but lately they have seemed to have gone up in price, especially compared to the Commodore Plus 4. This is the North American C16, and it only came with the unit itself. Nothing else was included, so I'll need to get some parts for this in order to make it fully working. So before we get into the restoration, let's talk about the history of the Commodore 16. In 1983, Commodore President Jack Tramiel was concerned that Japan would dominate the home computer market and undercut everyone's prices, so he responded with the C16, which released in 1984 and was intended to be an entry-level replacement to the VIC-20. With 16 kilobytes of RAM and an integrated graphics and sound chip called TED, it was not compatible with the VIC-20 or the C64, and it failed in North America after being discontinued 1 year after launch. It did fare better in Europe, however, selling closer to 500,000 units. So back to the restoration. The first and really only thing we need to do here is to give the case and keyboard a good cleaning. So I use Windex and a cloth to clean all the dust and grime from the case. As you can see, it's pretty filthy as it's been sitting in someone's storeroom for many years. I make sure I give each of the keys a good clean as well, but I'm not going to remove any of the keys individually. I may do this, however, after we power up the machine and test the keyboard if there's any stuck or keys that don't work. After a few minutes of scrubbing and cleaning, the case and keyboard have come up nicely. Now the next thing we need to do is get some parts in order to use the system. Unfortunately, it's not as simple as using a Commodore 64 power supply, joystick, or tape drive, as all the connectors are different. Let's take a look at them now. Okay, so on the right hand side of the C16 we have an input for power. This is a standard DC plus 9 volt connector, which means finding a power supply is pretty cheap and easy. Next to that is the on-off power switch. Next to that, a reset switch will perform a soft reset. Pretty handy actually, the Commodore 64 never had this feature out of the box. Finally, there are two joystick ports. As you can see, these are of the mini DIN variety, and are not the 9-pin standard Atari style. Fortunately, adapters are available that will convert an Atari joystick to a C16 pinout. Looking at the back of the unit, there is a memory expansion or cartridge port. This is not compatible with a C64 cartridge port, and it's its own standard. The C16 had memory expansions that you could plug into this port in order to bring the memory up to 64 kilobytes. Next is a standard RF connector to hook up to a TV. The video and serial ports are the only thing compatible with a C64. You can use the same video cables to connect to a monitor as you would a C64. You can also connect up a 1541 floppy disk drive to your Commodore 16 via the serial port. The tape port is used to plug in to a Commodore data set, but again, that's not compatible with a C2N data set, as it uses a mini DIN connector, totally non-standard. Okay, so I picked up a cheap replacement power supply from eBay, and when I plugged it into the Commodore 16 and powered it up, nothing happened. No power light, no anything. So as always, let's open up the system and take a look around and see what's up. If you've ever opened up a Commodore 64 or VIC-20, this will be familiar to you. Turn the case over, and with a Phillips head screwdriver, just unscrew each of the three at the bottom of the case. Then turn the case back over and lift the top portion of the case off. But be careful as the keyboard and power light are connected, so just remove them from the motherboard and you're good to go. Just like old retro computers, we have to deal with the shielding next. There's six screws that hold the shielding in place, and with the same Phillips head screwdriver, remove each of them. Then just lift the shielding away to expose the motherboard. This motherboard is pretty dirty, so I used some compressed air to clean it up a little. Also, while we are here, let's take a closer look at the hardware under the hood. The brains of the computer is the MOS Technologies 7501 or 8501 clocked at 1 MHz. They are essentially identical to a Commodore 64 6510 processor. However, it's not pin compatible and they are hard to find if you're looking to replace yours. The graphics and sound chip I mentioned earlier called TED can handle bitmap graphics of 320 by 200 pixels with up to 121 colors. Compared to the C64, this is pretty impressive and one of the only areas where the C16 and Plus 4 line of computers are superior to the C64. The TED also has two channel audio. One channel is square wave and the other could be square wave or white noise. The two RAM chips provide 16 kilobytes of memory. There is a popular mod you can do to replace these RAM chips and use two 4164 DRAM chips and expand the C64's memory to 64 kilobytes. The PLA or Programmable Logic Array chip is the glue that connects different parts of the computer together, including the CPU, I/O, graphics and sound. Finally, these two chips are the V3.5 BASIC and the C16 kernel ROMs. So back to my power problem. The first thing you should always do is check the fuse. So I got out my multimeter and tested it. And when I did, I was not getting any reading at all. On closer inspection, the fuse had blown. Now I don't know if this was something that I did or if it was this way when I got the unit. So I replaced the fuse with a brand new one. And when I connected it up and powered the machine on, this happened. I took a closer look at the power supply that I bought and double checked the eBay ad and just made sure that it was indeed compatible with a Commodore 16. Then I realized I had made a big mistake.
If you guys saw my Atari XE game system review, I had power supply trouble in that video as well. I basically plugged in the system without checking the power supply voltage, and that in turn caused a memory chip to actually blow in the motherboard, which I ended up finding out later that I had to replace. So it was an expensive mistake. Now I ended up purchasing a Commodore 16 power supply that was advertised to work on a C16 from eBay, and unfortunately the polarity of the plus and minus was inverted and it caused my fuse to blow in the C16 and it caused it to blow multiple times. So really I need to take more care and attention when I look at power supplies, especially third party ones that you buy from a reseller. Don't just assume it's going to work. Make sure you take the time to ensure that the polarity of the power supply matches what your piece of equipment is expecting, as well as just test the voltage and just make sure that it's the appropriate voltage for the equipment that you're trying to run.
The Commodore 16 expects a negative polarity. In other words, the positive Y is connected to the outside line of the plug and the negative Y is connected to the middle pin. Now, in my defense, I expected the reseller to advertise his power supplies correctly and accurately, and clearly he hasn't. But still, a couple of blown fuses isn't the worst thing that could happen, so let's go ahead and replace the fuse once again and connect an appropriate power supply and see if the Commodore 16 finally powers up. And there you have it, success! Now while we are in the garage, we're going to perform the 64 kilobyte RAM upgrade to the Commodore 16. It's pretty simple and only costs a few dollars in parts. I'll leave a link in the description below on how to do it.
So let's turn this on and hopefully we'll have 64 kilobytes of memory on our Commodore 16. And there you have it, 60,671 bytes free. Our 64 kilobyte mod is working. So now we're going to go ahead and take the machine back upstairs and reassemble everything.
To finish off the restoration, I picked up a C16 to Atari 9-pin joystick adapter, as well as a SD to IEC, which is a popular card reader that emulates a 1541 disk drive. This model has the MiniDIN connector that fits into the C16's tape port. Finally, my Commodore 16 can load and play all +4 games and demos.
Well guys, I hope you enjoyed this video of the C16 restoration. As always guys, don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll catch you guys in the next video. Bye for now.